In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God, amen. Good evening. So, we're in second chapter of the first epistle of St. Peter, and we're midway. So, just to recap really fast, the first chapter told us, be holy, for I am holy. And then the second part is to love each other. And then the first part of chapter 2, it told us about the new priesthood. Remember, we talked about the priesthood. And the question that I have for each one of you is that, how did he describe each of us, the believers? There were four adjectives that was used. Maybe we can go chapter 2. Let's go to chapter verse 9. So people, okay, so you can see it. What were the things that we are to be as believers? Huh? It's right there, verse 9. This is not chapter 2, Yabam. go to chapter 2. Oh, it is? This is second. First Peter. Okay, go back. First Peter, chapter 2, verse 9. Okay, here it is. So what are the four things that we are to be as believers? I want to hear somebody, come on, you can see it. What is the first thing? But you are a chosen generation. That's we are a chosen generation. Another, the second thing, a royal priesthood. And we talked about the royal priesthood. And then a holy nation. And then His own special people. So this is what we, as believers, we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, and His own special people. And then we stopped at verse 10, so we'll start by verse 11. So in verse 11, he's talking about to everybody also. He's continuing talking to everyone, men and women. Okay? And he's telling each one of us as believers, beloved. He calls us beloved. Remember, St. John always used to, remember when we were studying the epistle of St. John? He always used to start, he used to call us a what? A lot of times, beloved, beloved, the saints of the church. So he starts out in verse 11, he says, beloved, I beg you. Can you believe it? He says, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims. You know what sojourners are? Sojourners are people that are going out on a journey. They're going, they're, so basically this is not their home. They're just basically going on a journey. So we, as believers, this earth is not our home. So we are sojourners in this place. Remember in a part of the liturgy after the commemoration, as we are sojourners in this place. So this is not our place. So he's reminding them, you are sojourners. You are pilgrims. You are just here for a period of time. So because we are beloved, and he's begging us as sojourners and pilgrims, do what? Abstain from fleshly lust which wars against the soul. So we as believers, we need to be careful and abstain from the lust of the flesh. The flesh is always going to want to do things. And here St. Peter is telling you, you as believers, as a chosen generation, as a royal priesthood, as a holy nation, as a special people, we are to work hard on abstaining from fleshly lust. Fleshly lust comes in a many various ways. Laziness could be lust, or maybe looking at someone in the opposite gender in a lustful way. That's fleshly lust. So here he's telling us, be careful what you're doing, what your mind is thinking, what your eyes is seeing, what the songs that your ears are hearing. And if there is anything that has to do with fleshly lust, abstain. Abstain meaning stop. You know, no, don't eat. You know, like when we fast, we abstain from food, right? So we don't eat. So here he's telling us, abstain from fleshly lust. Why? Because the fleshly lust, war. You know what a war is? When there is fighting. So here he's saying, which war against the soul. So you're going to find this always. The body is created from where? Remember when God created Adam, he created the body from what? From dust. How about the spirit that's in us came from who? He breathed that spirit in us. So therefore, because that's what happens is the body, because it was created from dust, it's going to always want to do dust things, things of this world. But the Spirit, it came from God because He blew that Spirit in, He breathed that Spirit in us. That Spirit is going to always want to do what? Spiritual things. So there is always a constant war between the body and the Spirit. Body wants to do fleshly lusts, fleshly things, and the Spirit wants to do heavenly things. Here, St. Peter is saying, guys, be careful. He's begging us, abstain from fleshly lust, which wars against the soul. And then he's telling them something. Having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. So let's break this verse a little down. He's telling every one of us, is that having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, how you behave among people is very important as a chosen generation, as His holy, how you, your conduct in school, your conduct in home, your conduct everywhere as a chosen generation, as His own people, His holy nation, it's got to be a different conduct. It's got to be an honorable among the conduct. Why? And this is something really important because it's really relevant to what's going on these days. What we're going to be talking about is really relevant of what's going on this last week or so on. He's saying, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, because what happened is some of the people in the world would look at us as evildoers. If my schoolmates force me to do something that is not morally correct to me, they look at me and they say, oh, you're very weird. Why are you so closed-minded? Why you don't have a girlfriend like everyone else? Why aren't you doing this? Why aren't you doing that? And then they will look at you as closed-minded and then they call you evildoers. And you know what's happening in the world today? There are some religions out there, and specifically Islam, is calling anyone that does not believe in their religion, and that's what's happening. They're calling the people that were martyred as unbelievers, as kuffar, which is they're evildoers. So some people in the world will look at us as evildoers. But how are you going to deal with this situation? This is the continuation of the verse. We are supposed to be, our conduct supposed to be honorable among people because they'll speak against you as evildoers. But by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. Because of how you act in the middle of being accused and being all these things, that action is going to help them and it's going to glorify God in the day of visitation. What is the day of visitation? The day of visitation is that some of us, some of the unbelievers, there's a day that, that they just going to believe that, oh my God, the Lord Jesus Christ is the Savior. So that blessing will visit them one day. And their eyes will reveal. And when their eyes will reveal, she goes, oh my God, yeah, it's because of their good conduct. That's how people are gained. And you'll see this a lot in a lot of the people that are being martyred. And I'll give you an example. You know the man that was standing right at the bottom of the cross? His name was Longinus. That took part of in the suffering of our Lord Jesus Christ by piercing His side, he became a believer, and that's some of these things that is happening today, and you'll hear this in the martyrdom. The people that are witnessing the martyrdom, they become believer. I want to be like that man that's giving his life to Christ. And you know something, I've been reading a lot of what happening. When you read carefully, you will find there were 20 martyrs from Egypt. But the Islamic terrorists are saying there's 21. And you know what it is? I heard it in a radio station that one of them was recently converted. And he said that the God of these people that are steadfast in their faith in Christ, their God is my God. And he's one of them that was martyred. So you'll find that 20 of them are from Armenia, from Egypt. But one of them is from not. It's from a different place. Okay? So because of your good conduct, people in the day of visitation. This man in the day, that was his day of visitation. His eyes was opened and he says, I believe in their God. And you know something? In your school, if you're strong in your faith, in your conduct, because how you gain people, how do you witness for people? By your what? By your conduct. By how you behave. Okay, so we'll move on. So in the day, then verse 13, it says, therefore, submit yourself to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake, whether by the king as supreme. Submit yourself to every ordinance. You know what an ordinance is? Ordinances is law. So we have laws in the land. We, as believers, as a holy nation and sanctified people, we are to obey the law. If it says 65 miles, 65 miles. If it says that, you know, I need to do this, I need to do this. And I need to obey the law. That's what St. Peter is telling me. Because our good conduct. Okay, imagine if, by the way you do, and this is an example, you know, people have the cross tattooed in their hands, right? And say somebody has a cross that is tattooed in his, but he doesn't behave at all as Christian. What does that do? It almost gives a bad name for that cross that he has tattooed. So by your conduct, by people see how you behave and they will believe. That's how you witness for the Lord and you will bring people to Christ by your good conduct. Okay? So therefore, submit yourself to every what? You guys? To every ordinance, to every law. You as a Christian are to obey the law. Of man of for the Lord's sake, and you obey it because you're a Christian for the Lord's sake. Whether to the king as supreme, you know what the king supreme? Because basically at that time everyone was to submit to Rome, the laws that Rome did as the king as supreme. The king of Rome was the supreme at that time. The Roman emperor was the one that was in charge, and they put the law. And he said, "You need to obey the law." That's what it says. Then goes on to verse 14. It says, or to the governors, as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. And here he's telling us that these people that are put on top as leaders, their role is as to those who are sent by him for the punishment. But basically what their law and those who are ruling, like the governor or the Roman emperor, is supposed to punish the evildoers and praise the good. And here, let me read it again. And as to the governor, as to those who are sent by him for the punishment of evildoers, so these rulers are therefore punishing the evildoers, and that's why they put laws, and for the praise of those who do good. Why do we obey the law? And we see it in verse 15. For this is the will of God. God's will for each one of us is to obey the law. Okay, for this is the will of God, that by doing good, you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. So when I see, when a person that is foolish or a non-believer see you obeying the law, he will be silenced. What else you can do? And this is what's happening. You watch the families of those who were martyred, and I've seen this, small girls, or the mother of one of the martyrs. He says, I forgive them. I forgive that these Islamic terrorists. I forgive them. And one thing that struck me very hard, and this is the spirit of Christianity. A very simple mother, one of the martyrs, one of her sons, because one of the brother was asking her, Mommy, if one of these Daesh people is walking outside your apartment, what will you do? By the way, remember that they just killed her son, right? You know what this simple woman told him? I will invite him in and tell him, welcome, Habibi, that you welcomed my son to eternal kingdom. That's Christianity. Do you see how their eyes are open and they see it totally different? By your good conduct. Ambangelos is saying, I forgive ISIS. And this is Christianity, is we are to forgive. Yes, there's evil, but we are to forgive. By our good conduct, people will start coming and witnessing for Christ. And this is happening all over the world. There is happening all over the world right now. People see people. How can you just have a martyr? Your son is martyred and you are celebrating and you forgive those who killed. Because, and that's something weird. It's very, not normal for the world. But they see that and they say, there's something different. And this is how Christianity, by our good conduct, okay? And we are to obey the law, and that's the will of God. And for the, and then it goes on to verse 15, which we just read. For this is the will of God, that by doing good, you may put to silence. You will silence those who are, and the ignorance of foolish men. And then he goes on, as free. We are free. As free, yet not using liberty as a clock for vice. What is vice? This is a very interesting, important. Sometimes when, you know, we are free, right? Sometimes people think free in a very wrong way. Some people think, because I'm free, I'll do whatever I please. But that's not the true meaning of freedom. Because what happens is that sometimes when someone says, I'll do whatever I please, I'll start smoking. You know what ends up happening? You become a slave to that smoking habit. So you're no longer free. That habit all the time now controls you. So people think that, oh, I'm free, I can do everything. But you know something, as a Christian, not everything edifies. I need to be really careful what I do. Yes, everyone could be doing, having a girlfriend, having a boyfriend, doing things, watching things that are not appropriate. But that's not edifying for me. I need to be careful. Yes, I am free. But you know something, I will not use it as a cloak of vice. Because what happened is that free things, that the wrong mentality of freedom can enslave me, make me a slave of whatever that I'm doing. So I should not use that as cloak for vice. But as a bond servant of God. What was a bond servant? Do we remember? We talked about bond servant when we were talking in the epistle of Jude, of St. Jude. What was a bond servant? Do you guys remember? Anybody remembers? Okay, a bond servant, every seventh year, when you have a slave, the seventh year you free him. But what happens is that some slaves loved their master and they wanted to come back and serve him freely. And they say, you know what? Yes, I am free, but I want to, by my own will, come and serve you. And here he's telling them, and this is what we are. We are free, but we are choosing to serve him as his children. We are by choice. And he's telling you, he's telling each one of us, but as bond servants of God, we are free, but we are willingly serving him. Bond servants of God, honor all people. So how are we, as Christians, to behave? We are to honor all people. And it doesn't matter of his color of the skin. It doesn't matter of his race. It doesn't matter what his religion. What we are to do is honor who? I can't hear you. All people. Honor all people. What else we're supposed to do? Love the brothers. Love the brother. And we're not talking about that brother. They're talking about brothers. Okay. Love the brothers. Love everyone else. Okay. Love brothers. And then the third thing is fear God. And we don't fear God because we're afraid of God. No, because out of reverence, out of awe, we honor him. And honor the king. Honor the leader. Because we believe that God places the leaders. Who placed the President Obama right now? God placed him. We believe that God places leaders. Who places our Pope? Who places all the leaders? God placed. We need to honor them. Yes, they may not be perfect, but we need to honor them and pray for them. In the St. Mark liturgy, or the St. Cyril liturgy, we call it today, we pray for the president. We pray for the president. And that's something that it's very important. We are to honor the king, or honor whoever, the appointed, because it's appointed by God. We move on to verse 18, and one thing before we start verse 18. It's very important to know when it talks about servants here, it talks about slaves. And in verse 18, when it's talking about slave, it doesn't mean that Christianity promotes slavery. No, what it's talking about here is that at that time, some slaves believed and became Christian. So here you have a Christian slave. So here St. Peter is addressing that slave that started believing and became Christian. And here, that's what he's telling him in verse 18. And he's telling them, servants, slaves, be submissive to your master with all fear. He's telling them, obey. Just like he told each one of us, obey the law. And here, he's telling us, obey those who are above us. Obey your servant, that, you know, that with all fear. Not only to the good and the gentle, but also to the harsh. Not only to the good, you know, master that he's very nice to you. No, but also to the harsh. As Christians, we are to obey them. The only time that we're not to obey is that if we are commanded to do something ungodly, that we do not obey. Anything that away that takes us away from the command of God, that we do not obey. But otherwise, whether he's a harsh master or a good master, we are to obey. As Christians, as a holy nation, as a Christian slave, he's telling the slaves at that time, be submissive to your master with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the what? To the harsh. And I want to ask you a question. Sometimes we need to make sure that also in classrooms, sometimes, Abuna, this teacher is not very good. Doesn't matter. We are to obey the teacher. We need to follow the directions. No, we need to obey. And some teachers are good, some teachers are not, but we need to obey. Okay? For this is commendable. This is what God wants. He commends you when you obey whether the harsh or the good. If because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully, for what credit is it if when you are beaten for your faults, you take it patiently? So here he's saying is that what credit for you if you do something wrong and you penalized for it? What credit is that? You're basically reaping your consequence. But that's not what a Christian is. Is that you do something wrong, you reap the consequence, and sometimes we say, I'm suffering for God. No, you're suffering because you did something wrong, or you're being penalized with something wrong. But when does Christianity play a role? Is in the next verse. For this is commendable, if because of conscience toward God, one endures grief, suffering wrongfully. For what credit is it when you are beaten for your faults? You take it patiently. But when you do good, this is very important. This is us right now. When you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable. See that? Before God. So if you do good and you're suffering for that, that is commendable. These martyrs, they were not martyred for any other reason but the fact that they were Christians and they were strong in the faith. And by the way, I just want to make sure that you guys understand what the whole world saw is the last several minutes of their lives. But I'm sure they were persecuted. And these are the ones that held in their faith. They were strong in their faith and all that. So here he's saying, if you do good and you suffer, that is commendable. Okay? But when you do good and suffer, if you take it patiently, this is commendable before God. And then verse 21, for to this you were called. This is the reason we are on earth. This is the reason is that for us to be witnesses, for to do good, for by our conduct. This is why as Christians we are called. We are called to witness for him, to do the good. Okay, even when there is a harsh treatment, we are to always do good. For this is you were called because, and then he gives us the biggest example of all. The biggest of example of someone being cruelly beaten and treated for something he didn't do. And that's what we read in verse 21. For to this you were called. Why? Because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you should follow in his step. So here he's saying why we are doing that. Because God, Jesus Christ on the cross, he gave us an example. Why was Jesus crucified? Was it for his sins? Was it anything that he's done? But he didn't do anything to deserve crucifixion. But why was he crucified? For nothing that he was done. But it was because of someone else. And he gave us the best example of all. Jesus Christ on the cross was crucified, not for anything he did, but for our sins. Okay? Let me read it again. He's leaving us an example that you should follow in his footsteps. And then he quotes Isaiah 53:9, and he says, he who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth. There was no deceit in his mouth, no sins, but he was crucified for my sin. And then he moves on to verse 23. He says, who, when he was reviled, did Jesus Christ revile back? When he was reviled, did not revile in return. Let me ask you a question. Do you think he was capable in reviling? He could have called a legion of angels and wiped everyone out, but he didn't revile. For who, when he was reviled, did not revile in return? And then go on. When he suffered, He did not threaten. Do you see that? He did not threaten. He was suffering. He did not threaten. But what did he do? He committed himself to him who judges righteously. And he left the judging to the judge. He committed himself to him who judges righteously. And then verse 24, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree. You know what the tree means? The cross. When it talks about the tree here, it's talking about the tree, the wood of the cross. And he's saying, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we having died to sin, because of our sins we died, might live for righteousness. By whose stripes you were healed. By his suffering we are saved. And this is what St. Peter is telling us. By his suffering we are saved. And then he closes the chapter by verse 25. And he says, for you, he's telling each one of us, that you were like sheep going astray. You know how like sheep gets lost sometimes? And he's saying, you were like sheep being lost. But having now returned to the shepherd, okay, so now the sheep realize that it's lost, return to the shepherd, and he is the good shepherd, and he says, and overseer of your souls. And he reminds us that you were lost at one point, and now you're coming back to the good shepherd and overseer. Overseer in the Greek of this word is episkopos, which means bishop, okay? So the bishop's job is to do what? Who can tell me from the word that I just told you? He's an what? A bishop is an overseer. So bishop is overseer or episcopus. So he, our Lord, is our good shepherd, and he's the one that oversees us, okay? And he oversees our souls. So it's a very relevant chapter that we're going through right now, and I encourage you to read it. Next week, he's going to be talking to the wives, and he's going to be talking to the husbands. So today he spoke to the Christian slaves, and he spoke to the men and women that are believers. So next week he's going to tell how wives are to be behaved, you know, and how the husbands, and then basically how Christians are to deal with others, blessing others. And I encourage you to read chapter 3. So when we're talking about chapter 3 next week, you have an idea and you kind of have a glimpse. And I also encourage you to go read first chapter 1 and chapter 2 to kind of, you know, in light of what we discussed last week and this week and the week before, you have a feeling and you kind of grasp the first Peter. Ultimately, I want you to be familiar with these epistles. When it's being read, you can guess, oh, that's St. Peter. I remember when we were talking about that's the epistle of St. Peter. Oh, that's St. John. I encourage you to start getting familiar with these epistles, and all the glory be to our God forever. Amen.